Wednesday. It is Top 10 Wednesday, and as the title says, I'm talking about my 10 favorite female protagonists. We're going with the ladies, y'all. Now, protagonists are the ones who are telling the story. These are not female leads. These are not female main characters. They have to tell the story. So in at least one case, they aren't the people that are what the story's really about. But let's get started. In the honorary mention spot, because I have 11 I want to talk about, is Surreal Saw Diablo from the Black Jewel series by Anne Bishop. This is the only female lead that actually tells the story. Surreal was a whore, a bastard child of one of the most powerful and dangerous men in the world, marking her as a target. So she became a whore and an assassin, and eventually left both professions in book 2 to become just a lady of circumstance. She gets taken in by the rest of the actual Saw Diablo family because of her last name. It becomes like a cousin, and so she's around with all the male shenanigans. I really enjoy her. She's very different and badass, even when she's no longer an assassin, and I love that about Surreal. In the number 10 spot is Alyssa Card in the Twilight Chessboard by L.A. Knight. Alyssa is a normal girl who goes to Pillar Preparatory Academy, which is 99% Fae population, and it is ruled by two witch queens, Geneva, the Red Queen, and Lily, the White Queen. And on her first day of school, Alyssa pisses off both of them and refuses to follow their normal standards of you have to pick sides and you have to follow their rules. She breaks all the rules, kicks ass, and takes names while doing it, and frees a whole bunch of people. I've loved the two books released so far. LA Knight is giving this an overhaul. However, there will be a newer version that is much better and flows smoother than these previous editions. And the number 9 spot is Yoko from the 12 Kingdoms series by Fuyumi Ono. Now, only numbers 1 through 4 have been released in English, while the rest of them are only in Japanese. Dang it, I want them all. The main reason why I love this series is because of Yoko. Yoko is a typical Japanese girl, except for one thing: her hair is naturally red. Then a man named Kyoki shows up and says she is an empress and ruler of the Kingdom of Kyo in a different dimension and was born on Earth by mistake, and she has to return quickly. Monsters begin to hunt her, and she's quickly pulled into this new world where she gets a new body and face and doesn't look anything like what she used to. Has to travel fighting all these monsters to take the throne that's rightfully hers. Yoko is badass, not really so much in this book, but in book 4, Skies of Dawn, she is amazing. I love her growth and what she becomes and the type of queen that she ends up being. She is so good. Oh, Yoko, badass, badass. And the 8th spot is Allie from the Daughter of the Lioness Quartet by Tamara Pierce. Allie wants to be a spy, which shouldn't be that surprising considering her father is the spy master for the entire Kingdom of Tortal, but for some reason her knight mother, Alana, and her Spymaster Father George don't agree. In a fit, she decides to sail down the coast to her grandfather through her mother, and is captured by pirates and is sold as a slave in the Copper Isles. But this is all part of the trickster god's plan that she be able to change the Copper Isles and put a dark-skinned princess on the throne as the ruler, freeing the native people of the Copper Isles from their oppressive Caucasian overseers. Allie is awesome. She's kind of whiny at the beginning of Trickster's Choice, but by the end, she's pretty badass. Trickster's Queen? OMG. She is so cool. I love Allie's character growth. She is phenomenal, and she rises up to prove everyone wrong and does whatever she wants while still sort of following the trickster's plan. Not because the trickster's making her, but mostly because that's what she wants to do. And I just love that she does that and is badass all while wearing a dress. Number 7 is Noriko in From Far Away by Kyoko Hikawa. Noriko is another typical Japanese girl, but she keeps having very vivid dreams about this other world. But terrorist attacks are going around in Tokyo. They explode. She's walking home. A little boy loses his ball. She chases after it, and it hits the bag right as she runs up to it. But instead of being killed, she is thrown into the world she's been dreaming about. And there she meets a man named Izark. Throughout the series, she eventually learns that she is the awakening, who all of the nations of this world are looking for, because the Awakening controls the Sky Demon, the most powerful new demon that is around. And any nation that can control the Awakening can rule the world. Meanwhile, she's just having trouble understanding the language. This is a shoujo, which means it's four girls, which means although it is fantasy and has some pretty awesome battles, there's a huge romance plot, but it doesn't, like, overtake it. It's not a romance plot with a little bit of action. It's actually this epic fantasy, and then her and Izark are falling in love, and it's very sweet. I don't have more than the first four volumes, however, I have found a way to read it online, so I will link it down in the doobly-doo. However, if you do see the series, y'all should buy it and read it. It's so, so good. Number six is a character from a manga I don't own because it has a little bit of incest, and it squeaked me out. But I'm talking about Toru from Fruits Basket by Natsuki Takaya, or Natsuki Takaya, however you pronounce that. Toru has had a really rough life. Her father passed away when she was a toddler, and she barely remembers him. Her mother passed away the year before. Her relatives are terrible people, and so she decides she would rather live in the wilderness in a tent than stay at home. But she isn't in the wilderness. Instead, she is on the Asuma land, one of the most powerful families in Japan. Turns out this family is cursed, however. Certain members of the family have the spirit of the Chinese zodiac inside of them, and so some are the rat and the dog and the tiger and the snake, and if a member of the opposite gender touches their bare skin, they transform into said animal creature. This has been going on for generations, but for the first time, the whole cast is there, including God or the emperor in the orientation of the Chinese zodiac. The cat is also there too. And Noriko happens to be on the land for the outcasts of the Chinese zodiac in the Asuma family, where she meets Kyo. I lost their names. I'm sorry, I forgot their names. Their names are on the screen right now. What I love about this isn't even that aspect. The Asuma family is really twisted. They have let this run their lives. The cat is always imprisoned and abused and tormented by the other family members, and all the other members of the zodiac are under this heavy oppression from the emperor character. But being around Toru, the family learns to heal and to not let it control them and to transcend this curse. And that's what I love. She is kind of typical manga female character, that she's very bubbly and she's very upbeat. But at the same time, we get to see Toru break down more than once. And we learn that she's so bubbly and happy because she's extremely depressed, which is very realistic. A lot of people who have depression have this facade. Toru fits that mold while still having breakdowns and while still having moments of great fear. I love that she is made a better person at the same time everyone else around her is. I love the relationships and I love Toru. Number five is Anita Blake from the Anita Blake Vampire Hunter series by Laurel K. Hamilton. Now, I've only read the first three. I'm only going to read up to the first seven, but I do love Anita. Anita is 23 in the very first volume, this one, Guilty Pleasures. She is an animator, aka she creates zombies in a world where vampires and zombies and witches and voodoo queens and werewolves and were-whatevers are very much a part of the real world. But she's also a vampire hunter on the side. Anita is so cool. She is funny and snarky, has this go-get-em attitude, and I just really enjoyed reading her, especially in Guilty Pleasures. She faces overwhelming odds and is not ashamed to be like, I'm probably about to die. Well, I'm gonna kill this guy first. She's badass and still can be feminine. I mean, she fights in heels more than once, and she wears dresses all the time. I just really love Anita. Number four is Triss from the Divergent series by Veronica Roth. In this dystopian, the world is separated into factions. At the age of 16, each child has their choosing day where they get to choose which faction they're going to be a part of. In order to know which faction they should choose, they have to take a test. However, there is a rare group of individuals who don't fit into just one faction. They are called the Divergent, and they are being hunted and killed. And Triss is Divergent. She tests into three of the five factions. While just trying to live her life, she ends up having to go through this era of a coup and changes in the government. This is not going to just let this happen to her loved ones and her while lying down. I like Triss because she has a strong sense of morals, of what's right and wrong. And no matter what's going on, she doesn't let go of that. She just doesn't care. She knows what's right and wrong, and she's going to do what's right. And she doesn't give herself any excuses. And I love her for that, because so many don't do that. They usually let go of their morals and are like, well, this is an extreme case, so I'm gonna have sex with my boyfriend and other things like that. She's very tough. I love her romance with Four. I love her relationship with her family members. And even though a lot of people didn't like Allegiance ending, I actually thought that was very much Triss, and that's in character for her. Number three is another character from a manga I don't own, even though I want it so bad. I'm talking about Nakaba. I think that's how you say her name. From Dawn of the Arcana by Rei Toma. Nakaba is a princess. However, in this world, people with jet black hair are the royalty, and her hair is bright red, meaning she's not entirely royal. She is a half-breed bastard. Her mother married a commoner and left the palace, but when her mother was killed, she had to go back. Because of her blood, her grandfather or uncle, the king, decides to just ship her off to marry the enemy, knowing full well that they will probably kill her very soon. She's basically been locked in this tower ever since she was very young and arrived at the palace. Now that she has a chance to get out, she is not going to let anyone control her life. Not her new husband, not the enemy, not her family. She doesn't care. And Nakaba rises up to take control of her destiny and becomes this phenomenal character. I've read other stories with characters in similar situations, and I always compare them to Nakaba because she is just so tough. She just won't let you control her. She kills people, she is willing to wield a sword, she is willing to start a war, to end a war. She's just so great. There's not that many chapters in this. There's only 50 some chapters, so it's only about 10 or 12 volumes in total, so it's pretty short for a manga, but her growth is phenomenal, and she is so cool. So cool. One of my favorites. I struggled to not put her at the top spot. In fact, the other two, I struggled not to put them all in number one because they're so good. In second place is Sorsha from the Seven Waters series by Juliette Marillier. Sorsha is the protagonist in particular in Daughter of the Forest, the first book. And she is the mother or grandmother of every other protagonist in the series. I don't think the other protagonists could be as amazing as they are if they weren't descended from Sorsha. Sorsha is phenomenal, and yet she's not the typical badass. She only holds a knife when she has to. She never takes a life. She never even fights for her life, really. But she's still amazing. This is a fairy tale retelling of the Seven Swan Brothers, which is a remake of the Three Ravens. She is the seventh child of Lord Colum of Seven Waters, who marries the Lady Una, a sorceress who transforms all her brothers into swans. Sorsha barely was able to escape with their life that day and meets up with the Lady of the Forest, the local fey ruler, who tells her how she can break the spell off of her brothers. She has to stay completely silent and weave six shirts out of starwort, one of the most painful type of thorns. They're lanced with little poison and they're needle-like and, yeah, very, very difficult. Sorsha eventually ends up in, because this is in Ireland, she ends up in England among the enemy, continuing to weave. She's just so tough, not in the way that she can kick butt, but in the way that she is the master of her own fate. She doesn't let the sorceress win. She doesn't let people who hurt her win, ever. She fights and fights and fights for her brothers, for herself, for her people, and does it all by just being herself. She's naturally a quiet person, even before this. She doesn't let people control her. She doesn't let her brothers run her life. She doesn't let anyone run her life, and that's what I love about her. She's so cool, and she taught me to be proud of my Irish heritage, to be proud of myself for being who I am, and that I can be a strong person without having to even say a word. In the number one spot, this was undisputed, but I'm going with Teru from Dengeku Daisy by Kyosuke Motomi. Teru is not a typical Japanese girl. We don't know where Teru's parents are, but her brother died when she was in middle school. And before he died, he gave her a cell phone and said, if you need anyone, you can talk to Daisy and he will help you. And at the beginning of the story, Teru isn't relying on Daisy and he knows something's wrong. And so he moves into her life as the very rough Tasuku Kurosaki. This is another shoujo. So yes, there's a little bit of romance and it's a little weird because she's like 15 and he's like 22. She doesn't let people control her. Her brother was a programmer and there is this program that a whole bunch of people are looking for and her life is in jeopardy over and over and over again. And unlike what it sounds like, she doesn't rely on Daisy that much. She ends up getting kidnapped so many times that at the end, to piss off her kidnapper, she's in a cocktail dress at this party that she's forced to be at. She stands on top of the table and sings the Japanese national anthem at the top of her lungs. Another guy is trying to scare her and control her and maybe kidnap her again, and she calls him Brush Head because his head looks like the brushes that school children use to clean bathrooms in the Japanese school system. And he's so taken aback, he doesn't even know what to say. She is just 100% in control. She doesn't care if you're pointing a gun in her face. She doesn't care if you're going to drug her or not. The moment she wakes up, she's taking control of the situation at the age of 15 as a normal girl who has nothing really powerful to do. She's not a great hacker like Daisy. She doesn't have like government connections like her other friends. She's just this kid and she just is badass. She can't fight to save her life. She's pretty clumsy, but she's badass. And I love that. I just love that. Every chapter that I've read has blown me away with Teru's attitude. I mean, the very first scene, we read this cutesy, like, everything's perfect, my life is great, email or a text message, and he's going through and he looks down and she's standing in front of her scouring friends, getting sprayed in the face with hoses by the student council, and he's screaming at the student council the whole time, and the student council's like, now you're sorry, and she's like, not really, you're still ugly and stupid. That's pretty much her attitude. She's just so cool. I love Teru. She's got this, I'm not gonna take your crap type of attitude, and that's why she's number one. Alright, thank you guys so much for watching. Please give this video a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Subscribe to see more. Top 10 Wednesdays are every first and third ish, depending on if the first is on a Wednesday, because then I can't do it. But every first and third Wednesday of the month, every Friday is a book review, so stay tuned to see that. Good luck with your reading, and I hope you can find some female badass characters in what you read. I'll see you in the next video. Bye! Today, as the title says, hey guys, in the number 10 spot is Alyssa from Glass by L.A. Knight. In the number 10 spot is Alyssa Card from the Twilight Chess. In the number 10 spot is Alyssa Card from the Twilight Chessboard from the Twilight God. And there are two witch queens. I don't remember her last name. A man named Kyo? Yeah. I hope my phone isn't too cockeyed. Just realized. Pretty cockeyed. It's Kyo? Kyo. Itchy face. What's her last name? I don't know. I don't remember. Throne, there we go, and bleh. We get to see Noriko break down. I said Noriko, that's not her name. This, I do, I hate that they don't have blurbies on the back. She tests into three of, I said four factions, didn't I? No. Number three is another manga that I don't own, and is another, bleh. In the second, bleh, her brother's and meets up with the local fae rulers of the, and meets up with the seven shirts, not seven, no, that's not what I do, I did it wrong.